Thank you for clicking on this video. For those of you who have already watched my stuff, welcome back. Surprised you came back, but I appreciate it. For those of you who are new, make sure you subscribe so you can continue to get this sort of information and content. Now, today we're going to be doing something a little bit differently. Rather than take a topic and I provide data for you, we're going to look at something a little bit more recent in the news that have been going on. These are two things that I feel like are very important and that we need to talk about. So here we go. So we're going to start with this Vox Adpocalypse. Now, what this essentially is, it's been trending on Twitter recently and Facebook and just about everywhere. It's essentially a fight between two people, one of them being Steven Crowder. You probably recognize him from the Change My Mind segments. They are the most popular segments that he has. And if you don't know what that is, then you obviously haven't been watching YouTube or seeing any memes lately. But he is a right-wing commentator. He owns a channel called Louder with Crowder. And one thing that's important to note about him before we go any further is that he was first and foremost a comedian. So he was a stand-up comic. That's what he wanted to do as he was growing up. So he is a comedian who has a show about politics, meaning he's obviously going to try and be funny in his show. Now, whether or not you think that he is funny or not, or agree with his politics, doesn't really matter. But he himself is not a politician, right? He's a comedian, which is important. And it's essentially a fight between Crowder and this guy called Carlos Massa. Now, he works for Vox, hence the name Vox Adpocalypse, and he has a show that he does on Vox where they talk about, again, political issues. And in case you couldn't tell, he is on the left and Crowder is on the right. So they're not going to agree about politics just about ever. So what generally happens is when Carlos comes out with a video, sometimes Crowder will take that video and rebut it. So he'll give data and talk about why he disagrees with the video. While at the same time, again, because he's a comedian, he will allude to and sometimes make fun of Mesa for his sexual orientation or ethnicity or the way he speaks, things like that. So I'm not, again, it doesn't really matter how you feel about that, whether or not you approve of that or not. But I think it's important to note that because of that, Mesa took it and claims that Crowder has been harassing him and that YouTube is allowing people like Crowder to target LGBT creators and harass them, essentially. So he's arguing that Crowder should be banned because he is, quote, harassing him. And Crowder is saying, this is free speech. I'm not calling for violence. I'm just making a show where I'm making fun of people. So that's essentially the start of the Vox Adpocalypse. So who is the winner here? And the answer is actually nobody. In this case, we're all losers, and that kind of sucks. Let me explain what I mean. So initially, when YouTube looked at Crowder's page and they looked at his videos, they determined that there was nothing he had done to break their policies, so they weren't going to do anything about it. But the very next day, they did a complete 180, and they actually decided to demonetize Crowder. So that means that unless he changes some of his content and the way he does some of these things on YouTube, he will no longer be able to earn money through YouTube, which, as someone who has almost 4 million subscribers on YouTube, that's a pretty big deal. So Crowder lost because he's now demonetized. Mesa lost because Crowder is still on YouTube, and Mesa essentially wanted to get him and what he views as alt-right conservatives off of YouTube completely. And not only that, but the reason this is called an adpocalypse is because of things like this, which has happened in the past, advertisers pull out of YouTube. They stop advertising on YouTube, and that hurts every content creator. So anyone on YouTube who uses it to earn money, they're going to be affected by this in a negative way. So this is why it's called a Vox Adpocalypse. It's because of Vox, and there is probably going to be ads pulled out of YouTube, and that's going to hurt basically everybody. So going to, I guess, another topic, I wanted to talk about briefly the Nancy Pelosi video that was making rounds about a week ago. And I feel like this is important because, again, it deals with social media. So essentially what happened is there was a video going around about Nancy Pelosi where they took a video of her and they slowed it down to 75% of its original speed, which Nancy Pelosi isn't the most eloquent speaker to begin with. And I'm not either, so I'm not criticizing her, but I'm saying she sometimes slurs her words and stutters and all sorts of things. So when you slow it down to 75%, it essentially sounds like she's drunk. It makes it seem like she doesn't know what's going on. So that's what this video did, and it went It spread all over the place. It was on Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, all this good stuff. And it ended up getting more than a million views, which I wish I could get that many views. That's quite a lot. But because it got so popular, people started talking about it, and people were trying to push Facebook and Twitter to remove these videos. Initially, Facebook said it wasn't going to do it, but it eventually did get removed. Facebook says they didn't do it. The original content creator says he didn't do it, so it's kind of up in the air. But the fact is, it was removed from Facebook. But what I really want to talk about is the response to this video by the media. So the mainstream media decided to back the narrative that social media sites should have removed this video. They were upset about it, and they said that it wasn't fair and it was doctored, so it should have been removed. Now, I don't see how that's much different than the thousands, if not millions, of videos of other politicians that are taken out of context, because that happens virtually on a daily basis. I mean, first and foremost, you can think of President Trump, the comment he made about MS-13, calling them animals. And to this day, we still hear people saying that Trump referred to all immigrants as animals. But that's an aside. So that video and those comments are still up, but for some reason, this video should not have been up. But what's even worse than that is what the Daily Beast did. So they took it one step further. They decided to do some sort of quote investigation, as they call it, and they found the guy who originally posted this video. So a guy who made and posted this video to make fun of Nancy Pelosi and to just show, how much he doesn't like her, they found him and they wrote all about him in this article. Now, you may ask, how did they do that investigation? How did they find who he was? Well, the answer is simple, but it's also, to me at least, pretty scary. Someone on Facebook, a Facebook official, an anonymous Facebook official, they call him, told them who made and posted the video. Why is Facebook, why is social media giving out this information to newspapers when it is not related to any crime, and there's absolutely no reason they should have given away that information? It takes you back to the Mark Zuckerberg hearing in Congress when they were asking about, the data that Facebook gives out, and he was saying that they don't give out anything. Obviously they do. They put this guy's name, and so the Daily Beast decided to do their investigation. And not only did they focus on, him, his name, where he worked, his past relationship with an ex-girlfriend, they also talked about and brought up the fact that he is currently on probation, which does not matter. This essentially means that if you make a political video that ends up getting a million plus views, if it becomes viral, for some reason Facebook thinks it's okay for you to be doxxed in the mainstream media. This is beyond insane. No one in their right mind should be able to should accept that this is reasonable. This is not where society should be. Okay. As I said, this segment was going to be a little bit different. I made my opinion a little bit more known. When I'm doing a new segment like this, I'm going to do that just to give it a little bit more flair to it. But now you know what the Vox Adpocalypse is, and if you hadn't heard about that Daily Beast article, which I'm not surprised if you haven't, which I also did not link below because I don't want to support that, now you know about it, and let me know if you think I'm being unreasonable here. If that seems like reasonable journalism, then go ahead and let me know. But if it's not, which I don't think it is, then it's insane. So which of these two things do you think is most important? The Vox Adpocalypse or this Daily Beast article? Go ahead and let me know in the comments. Again, subscribe, and I will see you next time. Thank you for watching.